Holy God, Holy Mighty One, Holy Immortal One, have mercy on us.
Holy God, Holy Mighty One, Holy Immortal One, have mercy on us.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, gave thanks, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After the same manner also, when they had supped, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, drink. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me."
Jesus told his friends to do this henceforward, with the new meaning, for the remembrance of him. And they have done it always since. Was ever another command so obeyed? For century after century, spreading slowly to every continent and country, and among every race on earth, this action has been done, in every conceivable human circumstance, for every conceivable human need, from infancy and before it to extreme old age and after it, from the pinnacles of earthly greatness to the refuge of fugitives in caves and dens of the earth. People have found no better thing than this to do for kings at their crowning, for criminals going to the scaffold, for armies in triumph, or for a bride and bridegroom in a little country church, for the proclamation of a dogma, or for a good crop of wheat, for the wisdom of the parliament of a mighty nation, or for a sick old woman afraid to die, for a schoolboy sitting an examination, or for Columbus setting out for America, for the famine of whole provinces, or for the soul of a dead lover. In thanksgiving, because my father did not die of pneumonia. For a village headman, much tempted to return to fetish because the yams had failed. Because the Turk was at the gates of Vienna. For the repentance of Margaret. For the settlement of a strike. For a son for a barren woman. For Captain So-and-so, wounded and prisoner of war. While the lions roared in the nearby amphitheater, on the beach at Dunkirk, while the hiss of the scythes in the thick June grass came faintly through the windows of the church. Trembling by an old monk on the 50th anniversary of his vows, furtively by an exiled bishop who had hewn timber all day in a prison camp near Murmansk, gorgeously for the canonization of Joan of Arc. One could fill many pages with the reasons why people have done this and not tell a hundredth part of them. And best of all, week by week and month by month, on 100,000 successive Sundays, faithfully, unfailingly, across all the parishes of Christianity, the pastors have done this, just to make the people of God holy. To those who know a little Christian history, probably the most moving of all the reflections it brings is not the thought of the great events and the well-remembered saints, but of those innumerable millions of entirely obscure, faithful men and women, every one with his or her own individual hopes and fears, and joys and sorrows and loves, and sins and temptations and prayers. Once every whit as vivid and alive as mine are now. They left no slightest trace in this world, not even a name, but they have passed to God, utterly forgotten by men. Yet each of them once believed and prayed as I believe and pray, and found it hard and grew slack and sinned and repented and fell again. Each of them worshipped at the Eucharist and found their thoughts wandering and tried again and felt heavy and unresponsive and yet knew, just as really and pathetically as I do, these things. There is a little ill-spelled, ill-carved rustic epitaph of the 4th century from Asia Minor. Here sleeps Sione, who has found Jerusalem, for she prayed much. Not another word is known of Sione, some peasant woman, who lived in that vanished world of Christian Anatolia. But how lovely if all that should survive after 16 centuries were that one had prayed much, so that the neighbors who saw what one's life were sure one must have found Jerusalem. What did the Sunday Eucharist in her village church every week for a lifetime mean to Blessed Sione, and to the millions like her then and every year since? The sheer stupendous quality of the love of God which this ever-repeated action has drawn from the obscure Christian multitudes through the centuries is in itself an overwhelming thought. All that going with one to the altar every morning. It is because it became embedded deep down in the life of the Christian peoples, coloring all the lives of the ordinary men and women, marking its personal turning points, marriage, sickness, death, and the rest, running through it year by year with the feasts and fasts and the rhythm of the Sundays, that the Eucharistic action became inextricably woven into the public history of the Western world. The thought of it is inseparable from its great turning points also. Pope Leo doing this in the morning before he went out to daunt Attila, on the day that saw the continuity of Europe saved. And another Leo doing this 3.5 centuries later when he crowned Charlemagne Holy Roman Emperor, on the day that saw the continuity fulfilled. Or again, Alfred, wandering defeated by the Danes, staying his soul on this, while medieval England struggled to be born. And Charles I also, on that morning of his execution, when medieval England came to its final end. Such things strike the mind with their suggestions of a certain timelessness about the Eucharistic action, and an independence of its setting. In keeping with the stability of an ever-changing world, of the forms of the liturgy themselves. At Constantinople, they do this, yet with the identical words and gestures that they used while the silver trumpets of the Basileus still called across the Bosphorus, in what seems to us now the strange fairy tale land of the Byzantine Empire. And in the 20th century, Charles de Foucault, in his Hermitage in the Sahara, did this with the same rite as Cuthbert 12 centuries before in his Hermitage on Lindisfarne in the Northern Seas. This very morning I did this with a set of texts which has not changed by more than a few syllables since Augustine used those very words at Canterbury on the third Sunday of Easter in the summer after he landed. Yet this can still take hold of a person's life and work with it. Let us pray. Lord God, in this wonderful sacrament, you have left us a memorial of your suffering and death. May this sacrament of your body and blood so work in us that the way we live will proclaim the redemption that you have brought. For you live and reign, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
If this cannot